The Quran has what's called a falsification test. Now this is miraculous for any religious book to have a falsification test, because this is what scientists use. This is why Albert Einstein's theory of relativity was so well accepted, because he gave three falsification tests to his theory. So in the Quran, Allah gives two falsification tests. So the second falsification test that the Quran puts in, which you can check out, Allah says, if this book was written by any other than the Creator, inside you shall find many contradictions and error. Because men make mistakes. Now this book is revealed over 23 years. And this book is not just gibberish. This book is historical. This book contains elements of science.
Hamza either tries to deceive the young lady, either by mere foolishness. He claimed the Quran a book that contains science. We recognize science through a systematic study of the structure and behavior of the physical world through observation and experiment. Scientific texts are precise, clear and in-depth descriptions of a scientific hypothesis and its verification process using the scientific method. The Quran contains superstitious half-apocalyptic words describing natural phenomena foolishly and deliberately to deceive a medieval audience of its divine origins. The Quran is quite literally gibberish. And that is what the far majority of non-Muslim scholars agreeing.
Story of Moses. By those angels who extract violently and those who remove gently. Yes, please, go on. And by those that swim along and those who race each other in a race. Okay. And those who arrange each matter on the day the blast revigil, follow it by a second blast. Hearts that day will tremble. Hearts that day will tremble. Yes, please, go on. Eyes will be downcast. Wow, deep meaning. They say, shall we brought back to life? Ugh. Even after we are decayed bones, they say, then such a return is a total loss for us. Indeed, it will be only one shout. What the hell are you talking about? And at once they will be awakened. Wow. Has the story of Moses reached you? That's a question. When his Lord called him in the secret valley of Tuwa, go to Pharaoh. Indeed, he has crossed all bounds. Wow, he crossed. And say to him,
Those of you who have had a chance to read the Quran, have you noticed there are no complete stories? Have you noticed that? Have you noticed that when you read the Quran, it doesn't go, there's no theme that it follows? It jumps all over the place. It may start with John the Baptist, it may jump to Moses, then go back to Abraham, and then it may have something that come to another reference that you know nothing about, or it doesn't really begin or end. It assumes you already know the background to the story. And the Quran is full of that. It jumps all over the place. There's no chronology, there's no transitional phrases to help you to go from story to story. It's confusing, it's full of repetition. Jumps all over from one topic to another, inconsistencies in its grammar, law, and theology. Verbs have been left out, adjectives have been left out in other places, and that's why it's so confusing for Muslims to read. In fact, 20% of the Quran is not even understood by the scholars. A fifth of this book, even the scholars don't understand.
So this is from an Arabic scholar, Gert Pouwen, who's the one who, he's a manuscript scholar of the Quran. And he says, the Quran claims for itself that it is mubin, or clear. But if you look at it, you will notice that every fifth sentence or so simply doesn't make sense. Many Muslims and Orientalists will tell you otherwise, of course, but the fact is that a fifth of the Quranic text is just incomprehensible. This is what has caused the traditional anxiety regarding translation. If the Quran is not comprehensible, if it can't even be understood in Arabic, then it's not translatable. People fear that, and since the Quran claims repeatedly to be clear, but obviously is not, as even speakers of Arabic will tell you, there is a contradiction. So that's Gert Pouwen. And then we have, of course, the famous Ali Dashti in his book, 23 Years, says, the Quran contains sentences which are incomplete and not fully intelligible without the aid of commentaries. foreign words, unfamiliar Arabic words, and words used with other than the normal meaning, adjectives and verbs inflected without observance of the concords of gender and number, illogically and ungrammatically applied pronouns, which sometimes have no referent, and predicates, which in rhymed passages are often remote from the subjects. These and other such aberrations in the language have given scope to critics who deny the Quran's eloquence. So
the second falsification test that the Quran puts in, which you can check out, Allah says, if this book was written by any other than the Creator, inside you shall find many contradictions and error, because men make mistakes. Now, this book is revealed over 23 years. And this book is not just gibberish. This book is historical. This book contains elements of science. Now, the amazing thing about science is transitory. Science is theory until history reaches a period where they can test the theory, and then they can see whether they were right or not. And then if they're wrong, they tweak it and they change it again. Well, every single thing in the Quran that was revealed 1400 years ago, scientifically, is correct today.
Hamza Miad, you claim the Quran is an elegant book that contains scientific insights. We claim the Quran is an incomprehensible gibberish. I guess this argument is like we say boys are heroes, girls are zeros type of situation. We can't really know. But do you really think the Quran contains science, or you are just deceiving people?
I'm asking you a question. Can you read back again this verses when it says وَإِلَى الْأَرْضِ كَيْفَ سُطِحَتْ? You just read it on 20, Al-Ghashiyah 20. Can you read it?
Explain, and the earth, how it was leveled out.
Is it leveled out?
What does that mean?
Is it earth leveled out?
What does that mean?
Flat? It's flat. That's what it claimed in Quran. It says...
Well, I don't know what it started as.
Is what?
I don't know what the earth started as.
So you don't know how it's earth? Is it round or is it flat?
The earth?
Yes.
It's not even scientifically proven. There are people who are atheists like you who believe the earth is flat based upon non-religious reasons.
Now you're wrong again. I didn't say I'm a religious speaker. I said I'm irreligious.
You're an atheist.
I don't follow a religion. I'm asking you again, is earth is flat?
I don't know.
You said it's not proven. It's not scientifically
proven. It's not. It's not.
I met a man there. A scientist. He told me something. He told me... It doesn't matter.
It failed in proving in science. It was claiming it has science, but it's failed.
Now she's messed up now because she gave me something to bite on. And what she said, the Quran is claiming to be a book of science. Now we all know the Quran doesn't claim to be a book of science. Is correct today. So the question we have to ask ourselves, how could a man be so confident that everything he wrote in 7th century would be correct, read by today? This is evidence. See, you can only prove some of the science of the Quran wrong in the future. So if you spoke to a companion of the Prophet and said, oh, when a fetus forms in the womb and the stages of the pregnancy and the zygote and this and that, and you know, talk about the shape of the embryo and this and that, this couldn't be qualified or confirmed because you need an electromagnetic microscope to actually see the shape and of everything. You can't, it's invisible to the naked eye. Okay.
I'jaz al-Quran al-ilmi, that's in Arabic how we say it.
Where does the Quran make the claim this is a book of science?
Really? Al-ijaz al-ilmi, have you heard this word before?
Okay, Mariam. Does the Quran, you just said the Quran says it's a book of science. Where does the Quran make such a claim?
I'm telling you, Muslims claiming...
I'm not interested in Muslims. You said the Quran claims it's a book of science. So I'm asking you to show me in the Quran, because you're Arab, show me any surah of the Quran that makes the claim that this Quran is a book of science.
This brings me to my third point, which is the argument of the physical coherence of the universe, which is a Quranic argument, because today I'm just going to be sticking with the Quran. So, Islam also has an inbuilt system of falsification. Works in a similar way to science in many ways. Four challenges, which I'm happy to take questions on in the questions and answer or in the cross-examination. One, if this book was from other than God, the Quran says about itself, there would have been many contradictions. Chapter 4, verse 92. Number two, the inimitability challenge. Try and produce something like it. And there is a quantifiable way of doing so, which we can talk about in the question and answers.
Quantifiable, eh? Just like science.
Sometimes we belittle the Quran accidentally. When we see an ayah in the Quran that talks about, for example, the camels and how we created it, or when Allah says that you are an alaqa, you are a nutfatin min maniyin, or when Allah talks about natural phenomena, what do? Straight away we say, ah, scientific miracle. This is rubbish. Sorry. This is wrong.
So, according to Hamza Georges, the Quran is above the investigative, analytical capacity of science.
Because what we've done, we've made science into a god now. We've deified science. And we've limited the Quran. Science changes.
So, the book you published a couple of years ago was rubbish, after all, as now you admit. Guys, this is the comedy club we call Dawa Team. Okay, it is a comedy club. How can you escape that simple fact?
Islam makes a case for itself. Okay, it makes a case for itself. The Quran itself has falsification challenges. It actually says if you believe that this book is from other than God, then please try and find it. Oh, you would have found in it many contradictions. لَوَجِدُ فِيهِ اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا.
Do they not consider the Quran with care? Had it been from other than Allah, they would surely have found therein much discrepancy. When we substitute one revelation for another, and Allah knows best what He reveals in stages.
And by the way, the Quran says in chapter 25 that there are many sons. Because it says, تبارك الذي جعل في السماء بروجا.
No, it does not.
Pardon?
What does it say that?
Yeah, it says in chapter 25, تبارك الذي جعل في السماء بروجا وجعل فيها سروجا منيرا. There's two qira'ah. One qira'ah says سراجا منيرا and سروجا منيرا. There's two qira'ah. One qira'ah says سراجا منيرا and سروجا منيرا. One more time. There's two qira'ahs. One of them is Siraj al-Munira, and there's another one, Suraj al-Munira. The Siraj al-Munira means a shining lamp, and Suraj al-Munira means many stars. So a shining lamp means a star, and many suns, one sun and many suns. One sun and many suns.
Muhammad Hijab says there are multiple recitations to the Quran. In one recitation, it says one sun. In another recitation, it says many sons. But there is only one Quran, and it doesn't contradict itself. Of course, whoever not retarded understands he just admitted many Qurans and contradictions.
One son and many sons. So in other words, the Quran says that there are many sons. The cosmic picture of the Quran, therefore, is that there are many suns, many solar systems, because suns are accompanied with solar systems, and that they have many functionalities. Of them, there is a metaphysical thing which we can't see, which is that the Quran, that the stars or the celestial spheres, they actually pelt the devils or the jinn, because we believe in this this creation called the jinn. We haven't created the jinn and the human beings except that you worship. So these celestial bodies actually pelt them. How can you falsify that? I don't see the issue.
I met a man there. A scientist. He told me something. He told me it doesn't matter.
Previously on The Walking Dead.
In your head, zombie, what's in your head? Here's my proposal.
I give up.
Go on, one more proposal.
Don't throw pills.
You need to establish in black and white, as you said,
don't insult
that
yourself.
Jesus is the only true God of Israel according to Christ on admission. Are you ready to debate that? That is my debate proposal to you. That in black and white, you will debate me and establish, if I'm proven wrong, I will accept it. No problem. That's your book. I may be mistaken.
That's not true.
So, are you ready to debate this proposal? That Jesus Christ is the only true God of Israel according to Christ's own admission in the New Testament. Listen.
Are you happy with that?
The second proposal, I am, who has to say? Christ himself. Right? Number one. What does he have to say in black and white? That he's not, he's just God? No. He's the true God. Just true God? No. Only true God. Just only true God? No. Only true God of Israel. Right. Is it talking about the only true God? No. It says glory to our God. Is it talking about the God of Israel? No, it's not.
No.
So it failed in all four counts. So 1 minute and 27 seconds, the debate is over.
So, not really. No, the debate just started, but the real debate is you against yourself. Me, myself, and Irene. Okay, guys, this is Mansour, 3 days after.
You say that I am the God of Israel.
I mean, the Bible. He said, worship with this name.
No, once you say I'm the God of Abraham, let's say the God of Isaac or the God of Jacob.
God of Israel, look, why would God say to whole humanity, I'm the God of Israel? Is he not the God of Chinese and the God of the Indonesians and the God of the Burmese and the God of the Pakistanis and the God of the British? Is he not?
Who do the British?
Now listen to the words of Jesus in Revelations. Behold, I am coming quickly. My reward is with me to render to every man according to what he has done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last. Case closed.
Case closed.
Case closed.
Interestingly, again,
can we step that
this way? May be a debate strategy our Christian friends play. So for the benefit of the audience, let me present it to you. I never asked you to present Jesus as saying I'm God. You keep missing my point. I am saying Christ has to admit in some shape or form he is the only true God of Israel. Not just God, because there are many gods. There are many gods. Can you not interrupt?
And we, of course, as Muslims, we use the linguistic argument of the Quran for its miraculous nature, or predictions in the Quran, or preservation, or the sociological miracle, or the lost historical information in the Quran, and so on and so forth. There's lots of ways that we do it. However, I wanted to just cut to the chase and get to the main point. And the main point is that, firstly, you need to be sincere as a human being in your journey towards God. So if you're sincere and you're looking for guidance and you're praying to God to guide you, then you will clearly see Islam is the truth. So you need sincerity, and sincerity is needed before any of these arguments are used. You can,
and within the fitra, the innate disposition, there are forms of proto-knowledge in the Islamic tradition that God is a reality and that he's worthy of worship. But that clouded. So it could be that a sound rational argument, philosophical argument, whatever, can uncloud your innate disposition to awaken the truth within. Or it could be something else. Or it could be a combination of things. So when you ask me, it needs to be demonstrated, well, I need to find out who you are, because I don't know where your cloud is. Maybe you need a rational argument. Maybe you need a good hug. Maybe you need some love. Maybe you need some really strong Quranic verses to wake you up, because the reason for your disbelief is arrogance, right? Wake you up because the reason for your disbelief is arrogance, right?
He believes that this man called Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the final messenger of God, therefore whatever he says is true. Now, what I want to do is this. These are aspects of Islam that we all believe in and accept. What if I come along and I tell you something? I tell you hypothetically, before you do takfir on me, hypothetically, there is a sahih narration of the Prophet ﷺ that you have to wear a yellow hat on Sundays. Hypothetically. Raise your hand if you're going to wear a yellow hat on Sundays.
But I must agree, we are very touched with your skepticism. I mean, isn't that right? How was that? Ah, yes. First, you need to be sincere. Hello people, this is Socrates Sun. Please see this video. In this video, I will expose the Muslim charlatan who calls himself a skeptic, Daniel Hakikatsu, and how this shameless buffoon or point-blank liar used the African country Botswana to make his supposedly KO argument on how democracy doesn't bring economic prosperity. I just needed guys to Google 5 minutes Botswana, and this is what I found. But before we see what is happening in Botswana, let's see what he was saying.
Consider Botswana. Considered one of the oldest democracies in the Southern Hemisphere, one of the earliest adopters of LGBT rights in Africa, very high female involvement with voting and politics, but it has only 1/10 the GDP per capita of the US. So either way you look at it, there is no correlation between adoption of human rights and democracy with economic prosperity.
So why aren't they enjoying progress and prosperity? Let's call this question the Botswana question. If Harris cannot explain these discrepancies, if he cannot answer this Botswana question, then he should admit that democracy and human rights are just a big hoax. Harris wants people to hate Islam by trying to pin the issue of poverty and social dysfunction to Muslim countries, but as we've seen, it's not a strong connection.
Really? Okay, let's see now. Botswana.
No.
Formerly one of the world's poorest countries, with a GDP per capita of about US$70 per year in the late 1960s, Botswana has since transformed itself into an upper middle income country, with one of the world's fastest growing economies. In 1885, the British colonized the area and declared a protectorate under the name of Bechuanaland. As decolonization occurred, Bechuanaland became an independent Commonwealth Republic under its current name on the 30th of September 1966. Since then, it has been a representative republic, with a consistent record of uninterrupted democratic elections and the lowest perceived corruption ranking in Africa, since at least 1998. The economy is dominated by mining, cattle, and tourism. Botswana has a GDP, purchasing power parity, per capita of about $18,113 as of 2021, one of the highest in Africa. Its relatively high gross national income per capita, by some estimates the fourth largest in Africa, gives the country a relatively high standard of living and the highest human development index of continental sub-Saharan Africa.
Botswana, although having nothing to start with, 70% of the country is the Kalahari Desert. Despite all that, because of democracy, people are happy and thriving. One of the world's fastest growing economies, lowest perceived corruption ranking in Africa, the highest human development index of continental sub-Saharan Africa,
a paradise of human rights in Africa. Yet, Daniel used that as a case study against democracy. Daniel Hakikatsu, this brain-dead Islamist radical that pretends to be a skeptic, he wrote an article recently. He says, "Salute the Sultan. Brunei reinstates hudud for sexual deviance." He says, "If you have had a rough week or are feeling down in the dumps, I have just the news to cheer you up. The Muslim country of Brunei is implementing hudud to crack down on sodomites and fornicators." Reuters says, "This is exactly right. The Sharia protects all of our rights, individually and communally. When rectum sex enthusiasts are allowed to promote their gender-bending degeneracy openly, that deeply harms all of us. That brings down the moral character of society. That destroys the sanctity of marriage." Okay, Daniel, let's go one by one. In this video, first of all, I will... How you say this word? Molestation? How was that? Let me read that because it's interesting. Sorry about that, guys. One second, please. "This is exactly right. The Sharia protects all our rights, individual community. When rectum sex enthusiast..." Yes, that's exactly what I will do to you. Daniel, in this video, that's exactly what I will do to you.
If you've never heard of Brunei before, it's a tiny oil-rich nation in Southeast Asia on Borneo Island, surrounded by Malaysia and Indonesia. About two-thirds of its 500,000 residents identify as Muslim, and it's considered to be the most observant Islamic nation in Southeast Asia. So when I arrived on my very first day in the capital city called Bandar Seri Begawan, I was super excited to visit the amazingly beautiful mosque. So I went inside, I was dressed in my proper attire, I took off my shoes for respect, and after 5 minutes of being inside, I was aggressively kicked out by two locals for reasons that I don't know why. I was there on a Monday afternoon and it wasn't during prayer time, I was just like any other tourist trying to check it out. And all these guys had to do was politely tell me to leave and that would have been fine. But I was bullied my way out the door and that thought cannot leave my mind to this day. It didn't take me long to realize that Brunei has horrifying human rights laws. In fact, they recently implemented a law that you can be stoned to death if you're gay. Stoned to death. There's also heavy discrimination against non-Muslims, which might explain why I was kicked out of that mosque. You see, Brunei has no freedom of speech, no freedom of press, and everything is controlled by the government.
Botswana had the lowest perceived corruption ranking in Africa because of democracy. Yet Brunei, everything is controlled by the government. Full corruption, in other words.
In addition, the level of corruption in this country amuses me. Brunei is sitting on lots of oil for such a small country, and hence, it's rich. One of the world's richest men is the Sultan Hassanal Bolkiah. His net worth is $20 billion, yet the country looks like it's still stuck in the 80s, and his people are suffering in poverty. If the Sultan spread just half of his wealth to Bruneian citizens, they'd each get a check for $23,255. Oh yeah, and maybe he could also donate one of his 600 Rolls Royces as well.
But wait, according to Hakikatsu, we should salute the Sultan of Brunei and his 200 Rolls Royce. Hakikatsu, you are totally exposed, my friend, for the charlatan that you are. Shame on you. You charlatan. Okay. In one hand, you accuse Botswana, a thriving democracy, that because of democracy, it's got tourism without having anything. They are doing well in a country 70% desert, and you accuse them as your KO argument against democracy and human rights. And on the other hand, you praised a ruthless dictator that keeps his people in poverty. Shame on you. you shameless buffoon. Okay. In one case, because Botswana was democratic, Daniel condemned this country contrary to human and social well-being. In the second case, Daniel, because it was Islamic, praised a ruthless dictator and a completely corrupted country where people are starving, although the country is rich in oil.
For the purposes of this discussion.
What is that definition?
Yeah. And that's the definition I used.
Which I said
was something absolute, something that's not going to change, and something that can't be revised.
When it comes to evolution, according to Ahmed Sobour, a fact is something absolute, something that is not going to change, something that cannot be revised.
Now, what's the criteria to test whether something is or is not a genuine prophecy? I want to ask you that. How would you discern the truth from falsehood?
You'd use empirical evidence.
Exactly, you would use empirical evidence. Something verifiable, something falsifiable, and something precise.
When it comes to Islamic prophecies, suddenly the fact is something verifiable, something falsifiable, and something precise.
My parents are not Muslim. My wife is in the audience and she... She knows how much I love my parents. You can pray for your parents. I can't pray for my dad when he dies. This is the reality. Don't underestimate the blessing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you. In our Aqidah books,